research fellow at Microsoft Research India, and this is a joint work with Amit Sharma and Chen Othon. I'll be presenting our paper explaining machine learning classifiers through diverse counterfactual explanations. So there are many techniques to explain machine predictions. As we all know, machine learning is being increasingly used in societally critical domains. Most of these techniques are feature importance-based method, where they provide important scores for features depending on their contribution to predictions. So however, these feature importance-based methods do not tell a decision subject what they should do in order to get a desired outcome that they want, which is the most important thing a user might want to know if they receive an undesired outcome in particular. To explain the situation, consider a scenario where a person applies for a loan and gets rejected by the loan distribution algorithm of a financial company. In such case, feature importance-based method would highlight the most important feature, say in this case, the annual income that contributed to the prediction. However, it does not say what the person could have done on the annual with the annual income to get the loan. And that's why a different class of explanations called counterfactual explanations, as most of you here might know, exist that provides these what-if scenarios that tells the person what they could have done with the feature to get the outcome that they want. And so now what are the desirable properties that must be present in a counterfactual? So ultimately, the user should be able to make the changes indicated by the counterfactuals, and this is called actionability. For counterfactuals to be actionable, we identify there are different facets of feasibility that must be satisfied. So first one being proximity, which means that counterfactual produced should be maintained as close as possible. Then it has to obey user constraints, which is about, say, some features in a counterfactual can't be changed. Then it's about sparsity, which is about changing less number of features as possible. And finally, we should obey the causal constraints, because features in the real world do not change independently, which means that, say, if someone's age is increased, so for instance, age and education level are very correlated, so one cannot be changed without the other. However, since users can have different preferences, feasibility constraints are not always easy to satisfy, and that's why we propose diversity should be another important factor for actionability. Like other fields such as recommendation systems and search, we argue that users should be provided with a diverse set of options from where they can choose the one that is more convenient for them. And there are two important works in this line. So one, the work by Wachter et al., which focuses only on proximity, and the second work by Russell, which considers the importance of diversity, but to focus only on explaining linear machine learning models. So we propose a general optimization framework to generate actionable counterfactuals, and the different parts of our objective function takes care of different desirable properties. And to generate k-diverse counterfactuals here, as you can see from the function, we use a determinantal point processes-based method, and we generate all counterfactuals at once in contrast to the prior work. So in addition to the laws, we also consider several practical problems that needs to be considered while generating counterfactuals, such as the choice of Y laws and the different scales of features. While these considerations might seem trivial from a technical perspective, we believe that they are very important in supporting user interaction with counterfactuals. And further, we have open sourced a Python library on GitHub that takes into consideration of these practical concerns while generating diverse counterfactuals for any data set. We call this library DICE, which stands for Diverse Counterfactual Explanations. So here's an example of counterfactual generated by DICE for an example data set, adult income data set, where the machine learning model is trying to predict the income level of a person as either high or low. The first row here is the feature set, and the second row is the feature values of an individual whose income is predicted as less than 50K, and below there are four diverse counterfactuals that are generated by DICE. And clearly the explanations here indicate that there's a bias either in the data or in the model constructed. Okay, so now how do you evaluate the counterfactuals generated by DICE or any other method? So while past works on counterfactuals have relied only on qualitative evaluation, which has its own benefits, of course, we believe a quantitative framework is important to benchmark and compare different counterfactual methods. And so our second contribution in this paper is to propose such a framework, and this has two components. The first one is where we propose different methods different metrics for comparison of different methods, and second is to evaluate whether counterfactuals are really helpful to an end user in extrapolating the machine learning model's decision boundary. So first, we propose four metrics that evaluates different counterfactuals method, and we made sure that they are different from the one that we used in counterfactual generation, so that we obviously don't perform better. And second, we want to evaluate if counterfactuals help user in extrapolating the local decision boundary of the machine learning model. That is, given a decision boundary, the test instance and the counterfactuals belonging to different class, can users predict outcome class of points that are closer to them? Since a real experiment is not always, real user experiment is not always possible, as a first step in this paper, we simulated this experiment with a simple distance-based classifier and compared different counterfactual methods. And this is the result of a first experiment where we compare our method to other baselines in explaining nonlinear models. So the x-axis in all these figures are number of counterfactuals that we require, and here it ranges from 1 to 10, and the y-axis is the scores for different metrics. In the leftmost figure, the score is for percentage valid CFs, and the second and third figure, the scores are for diversity and proximity for categorical features. And this is the result for adult income data set, and the blue dark line is our method, and the other lines are other baselines. And in all these figures, the higher the value, the better it is. And as you can see from the first figure, our method produces 100% diverse counterfactuals and valid counterfactuals, still k equal to 10, while other methods do not. Further, they are very diverse and hence more actionable, as we discussed in our paper. However, this diversity comes at the expense of proximity, which indicates that there's an inherent trade-off in between these two, and we discuss more on this in the paper. Moreover, we were able to produce good results in explaining linear models where we get both higher diversity and proximity compared to other baselines. And this is the result of our experiment where we are trying to approximate local decision boundary. The x-axis here is the same. The y-axis is the F1 score of the classification. And so we compared with several baselines. For the purpose of presentation, I am presenting the comparison only with Lyme. So surprisingly, our method can approximate the local decision boundary with only less than 10 points, at least as well as other methods like Lyme, which were solely optimized for this purpose, right? And that uses 5,000 data points, while other method was based on very few data points, and mostly, in most cases, it's less than 10. So in summary, our contribution is two. We propose a general framework to generate diverse counterfactuals. And second, we proposed a framework for evaluating quantitatively any counterfactual method. And in the future, we would like to address three main issues. And currently, we are focusing on incorporating causal knowledge during the counterfactual generation. Thank you.